Hi guys, welcome back to our next mini online lecture. Seeing all the freshers flogging the campus, I thought an introduction into how to write an academic paper or how to write a paper at university would be the most appropriate topic. So this particular mini lecture aims on telling you a little bit of how you approach writing an academic paper. And if you have any questions, of course, you can as usual comment underneath the video, but you can also send us a tweet on Consult a Gecko. So now I'd like to dive into the topic right away to keep it as short and sweet as possible. So the main structure of an assignment, of course, is introduction, main part, and summary. And I will explain this with the sandwich technique, which I have invented when I worked as a learner support tutor. And yes, I know that sounds like a food-obsessed German, but believe me, once you understand what is behind that sandwich technique, you will never forget the structure of an academic paper or of a paper again, and it makes it really, really easy to remember. So the first part of the sandwich is the base layer. The introduction is the foundation of your whole paper. What the introduction's purpose is to establish a context. That means in the introduction, you bring your topic from the wider context of your research field or of your academic field and narrow it down to the particular topic or theme of your paper. What you also do in an introduction is you justify why you've chosen that topic or why this topic is significant. Maybe there are some temporary developments in the field, or maybe there was some new research out or some new findings you want to discuss. So establish the context and talk about the significance. Another thing you sometimes do in introductions is you establish terminology. If you use terminology that is subject specific, make clear why and how you use certain terms. Because, as you know, in academia, terminology can be a very tricky topic. And if you use terms, make sure you say from which school of thought you're coming or from which perspective you're coming and how you use this terminology. Again, reference to academics, to researchers which have used these terms in the way you intend to do so. The next part is the filling of the sandwich. This is the main part of your paper. I will discuss this main part in the different layers a sandwich has, you know, cheese, tomato, salad, vegetable, whatever you're thinking of. And the first layer I'm starting with is think structure. You don't want to have soggy bread in a sandwich, so what do? You put salad on the top, on the bottom, so that all the sauces and watery stuff from the filling cannot make the bread soggy. In terms of your academic paper, you think about structure. You think about what headlines are you going to use, maybe what subheadlines, and how do you make your argument the best way? You know, which topic leads from one to another, how can you build up from one to another topic? What I usually told my students was start with writing your headlines and then think about as many subheadlines as you want to. You delete most of them later, but it will help you finding a start in writing. And then underneath each subheadline, you put on bullet points, you put on references from papers you want to read to the subject or about the subject. You want to put in ideas you have, things you want to discuss, themes you want to discuss. So make the structure your paper well, and then start writing. The second layer of your sandwich is the main ingredient. So make your sandwich tasty. That means consider the main authors in the field, the key ideas of the field. But that's not all. These are just the basics of the filling. You want to spice it up a little. And in academic paper, it is your interpretation of the topic, your critique of the topic and of the authors. What ideas are out there in the field? Do you agree? Do you not agree? Who does agree with you? Or who does disagree with you? And make the argument about it. For instance, Should there really be cranberries on the brie? If yes, why should they be there? If no, why should they not be there? And is anyone else thinking the same like you? Reference it, bring some quotes, and don't forget the next part of the filling, which is need to cover issues. Have your five a day. That means cover as much as possible. You reference people who support your ideas and who support your argument, but that shouldn't be the only references. You also need to consider scientists, researchers, academics, which have counter arguments to the way you want to see or want to approach the topic. You have to acknowledge that in the paper as well, so that the reader knows you have a wide understanding of the field. And of course, make sure it is contextualized with your introduction. It refers back to your introduction and to the questions you've set out to answer. Another good idea also is to look at your lecturer's or professor's research background and see what papers or books they have published, because in these you will find additional literature in the reference list, and this might help you to find more reading you could do and you could include in your papers. One of the best parts in a sandwich is the sauce or the butter or the mayo you're using, but keep in mind, not too much mayo, please. In an academic paper, you need so-called fillers, but fillers are as crucial as they are difficult to use, and you need to pay attention to that. Fillers in the sense of add-on words and empty sentences that do not contribute to your argument are useless. Delete them. Fillers that are important are things like linking words, cross-references, linking between sentences, linking between paragraphs. You know, one paragraph has to build up on the next, and so on. So these cross-references and links, they are important. They are the really good source for your paper, but keep in mind, do not use filler words to up your word count on a paper, because whoever creates your paper will see through that. Another important part in the source department is references and sources. These are things with which you can support your arguments. You know, you lead an argument in a certain way, add a reference to whatever researcher, academic, scientist has agreed with you. Find the counter argument and let the reader know why you think this doesn't fit with that, this doesn't fit, this isn't right. So use the references to support your arguments and also to show that you've done your reading. Now, the last advice and the last part of the filling is eat healthy. Think Jamie Oliver, honest food directly from the source. Go for the homemade, your own ideas. Usually we want to see own ideas from students in the papers. No plagiarism. That means if you make an argument, make it very clear what parts of the argument are your personal ideas, are your own ideas, and what parts of the argument are referenced, are from a seminar, a journal article you read, a book you read, a lecture. If you're not quite sure if you should reference an argument, I recommend you do the Jimmy test. Now, the Jimmy test is following. When I moved to Glasgow, a taxi driver told me that if I ever wanted a guy in the street to turn around, I just have to shout out loud, "Jimmy!" And he said about 80% of the guys will turn around because most guys in Glasgow are called James. So no matter how seriously you take that cab driver, it is a really useful picture to have in your mind. Now, if you want to use a certain phrase, for instance, rolling hills, and you are not sure if you need to find a poet who used it in a poem and reference it, or if you just can use it because it's just an idiom that everyone knows, then imagine you are calling out for Jimmy and a total stranger in the street, and you go to him and you tell him whatever, the numbers of the world population, or you tell him about the rolling hills, or you tell him about the year of the Battle of Hastings, and you're not quite sure if you should reference it. Imagine you go to Jimmy on the street and tell him this, and imagine how he would react. And if you can really see him going, huh, and his eyes go completely blank, then you should probably reference your data. So, what I want to tell with this little story is, if you are in doubt, find a reference. If you have some problems finding a reference, or you're not sure if something should be sourced, should be referenced, you can always go to the research librarians and ask them. They are able to help you. And also, if you can't find a reference or a source, they can help you find it in the specific databases. So, to summarize, the main part, the filling of the sandwich, is first, think structure. You don't want to have soggy bread, structure your sandwich. Second, main ingredients, make it tasty. That means consider the key authors, consider the key topics in the field, and also bring some counter arguments. Third, need to cover issues. Have your five a day. Have you discussed the topic comprehensively? Have you looked at counter arguments? Have you done a little bit more extra reading than was required? Fourth, the source. Use linking in your writing. Use your references to support your points. And fifth, eat healthy. That means honest food, no plagiarism. If you're not sure about plagiarism, ask in the library or look at your department guidelines for plagiarism. And there are a lot of things also on the internet about plagiarism. So, and now the final layer of the sandwich, the top half of the bread. Close your sandwich, summarize. You have to summarize your paper at the end, and the task of the summary is similar to the one of the introduction. It means contextualization, but this time it is the other way around. You start with summarizing the main points and outcomes from your discussion, from your paper, and then you bring it into the wider context of the research, of the field, of the academic field you are studying in. So think about the both sandwich halves, the top and the bottom, they are holding your main argument, the filling of the sandwich, together, and they have to relate to each other. What you have in your summary needs to reflect what you had in your introduction, and it needs to reflect a little bit on the way of how you got from the introduction to the summary, and what does this mean in large. So think about the both layers of bread holding your argument together and contextualizing it. Wrap it up. It is really important that your formatting is to the standard of your institution. So check online for the guidelines for formatting. That means what are the document margins, what are the fonts you can use, what are the font sizes. Also for the referencing, which system does your institution use? You know, is it using Harvard or is it using APA? And consider the Harvard referencing system has something like 15 different versions, so make sure you are within the guidelines of your institution. Also, insert a content table. If you have graphics, if you have tables, label them, number them, put an index for these graphics and for these tables in your paper as well, and proofread your darn paper. Don't forget to proofread, because if you have a paper and it may be a good argument, it may be well referenced, but the formatting isn't up to standard and you haven't proofread it, it will seem as if you have not taken it seriously. And believe me, there is no academic who likes someone who doesn't take their topic seriously. So really, check the formatting, check the proofreading. So, and that's us. If you want to know more about writing a report for academia, the principle is similar, but you have to check with your department, because I know different departments have different structures of what they want from students in their reports. And you should check with your departments about that. And if you have any questions, as usual, you can leave comments underneath, or you can tweet us on ConsultAGecko or find us on LinkedIn.